Hello everyone, please confirm your attendance by sending message, okay, in the chat messages. So by this message you are confirming that you are attending this lecture. Okay, today we will talk about the second lecture for our course, okay, of our course about radiation safety principle in nuclear medicine. Okay, I'm Dr. Islam Kamal, okay, I'm a PhD consultant in medical physics, and I'll talk with you today about the radiation types, units, and biological effects. First of all, we have to know our outlines today. We will talk about radiation we live with, we will talk about the radiation types, biological effects of radiation, radiation units and the quantities. Please, today I want you to focus with me because it's like refreshment. So I will refresh your mind. I will talk about the basic principle of radiation safety. So you will, I'm sure 100% that you hear all this information before. So I want you to understand well. So if you have any queries, I want you to discuss it with me by end of this lecture. So we are just remind and just refresh your information. First of all, radiation we live with. Okay, so I want to put in your mind that the only issue we have, that the real hazard is not in well-known risks, but in the assumption of safety. Is there any radiation in this room? Okay, first of all, I want to confirm if you are hearing me well or not. My voice is clear for everyone? Okay. Is there any radiation source in your room? Now you are hearing me inside your room, so do you think that there is any radiation source around you? Yes, of course. There are many sources around you of radiation, but not all forms of radiation are harmful. Like what? You will find that a lot of radiation coming out from cosmic ray, plants, from Earth, from our bodies as well. Every day you are eating food, different foods, you are drinking milk, you are eating different foods, these foods already contain a certain amount of radiation. You are exposing yourself every day to cosmic rays, which come from sun. This cosmic ray is a type of radiation. Your ceiling inside your room, the ceiling inside your room contain a certain amount of radiation. The ground contain a certain amount of radiation. Building material also contain a certain amount of radiation. Your mobile phone, your laptop, radio waves, TV, microwaves. So there are many different sources of radiation around us, and we are living with radiation every day, and we are exposed to many different sources of radiation. But radiation, you cannot smell it, you cannot touch it, you cannot hear it. Only visible range of radiation, you can't see it. Okay, so you are dealing with something, or you are dealing with something which is invisible, and you are the only person who knows the properties of radiation, and you should get more experience how to deal with radiation, how to protect myself from the radiation hazard, how to protect public and patient from radiation hazard. So this is important to know more about radiation. You'll find different radioactive material in the body. Coming from where? Your body contains radiation. If you measure the radiation background using survey meter, you will find reading. You will not find zero reading, but sometimes you will find 0.0001 microsievert per hour. So from where this value you got it? You got it because there are many sources of radiation around you. Even your body contains a certain amount of radiation. Your body contains, if your body weight is 60 kilograms, so you'll find your body contain potassium 40, carbon 14, rubidium 87, tritium, lead and polonium, different source of radiation, which come from food. You will find that the most common or the highly concentrated activity of radioactive material is coming from potassium 40. 0.01% of potassium is radioactive inside your body. And this potassium 40 emits beta and the gamma radiation as well. So your body contains a certain amount of radiation. Your daily intake from rice or wheat or pulses, vegetables, milk, you will find different types of radioactive sources like radium, like thorium, lead, and potassium 40. The highly concentration of radioactive material inside your food comes from potassium 40. For example, here, if your body weight is 70 kilograms, so at that time your body contains 140 grams of potassium. As I mentioned before, that the radioactive potassium inside the potassium is the percent is 0.01% of potassium. So that means your body contains around 0.016 grams of potassium 40, which is equal to 0.1 microcurie of potassium 40. That means potassium 40 is in, which is radioactive inside your body. So your body emit all the potassium 40, which is inside your body, gives around 24,000 photons emitted per minute. And time half-life is 1.3 billion years. This potassium 40 emits 89 beta and 11% of gamma ray and 89% of beta particles. So your body contains a certain amount of radiation. So radiation everywhere. That's why you will find background radiation. If you are working as a medical physicist or radiation safety officer in nuclear medicine department at a certain country like New Delhi in India or Iran or Kenya or anywhere, you will find different values of background radiation. It depends on the nature of the country itself. If you are talking about Iran, so you will find a lot of mountain there. So you will find the background radiation is very high. I'll give you an example now. For New Delhi in India, you will find the background radiation is 0.079 microsievert per hour. Bangalore in India is 0.09 microsievert per hour. Bombay is 0.04 microsievert per hour. If you are talking about Iran, the reading here is higher than India, which reached to 1.1 microsievert per hour because of the ground nature there. So we'll find mountains which contain uranium and thorium, okay? So which rise up the background radiation. Also in Bharatel, you will find the background radiation is 1 microsievert per hour. And also here in UAE, in United Arab Emirates, you will find the background radiation is 0.03 microsievert per hour. So this reading coming from the area around you, from the earth, from the building. So it depends on the nature of the country itself. So even if you are traveling from your country to another country, okay, if you check your height, you will find that you are at height around 33 kilometer, okay, from the sea level. If you are at 15 kilometers from the sea level, you will get exposed to 10 microsievert per hour. So that means if you fly 3 hours, you will get 30 microsievert per hour, 30 microsievert as an effective dose, okay, by end of your flight. Okay, so you are under radiation exposure everywhere. Even if you are going to the sky, you will get radiation exposure. So you get radiation from food, You get radiation from flight, you get radiation even in your kitchen, you'll find radon gas. Okay, the ceramics inside your house, you'll find also emitting radon gas, which is radioactive material. So radiation everywhere. And we are dealing with radiation every day. Let's move to the another point, which is types of radiation. If we classify the types of radiation according to the energy, we'll find that we are talking about two main types of radiation, ionizing and non-ionizing radiation. If I ask you now, can you give me an example for ionizing radiation? Example in our medical field, you will find all X-ray machines. If we are talking about dental machine using X-ray, if we are talking about fluoroscopy machine, CT machine, computed tomography, okay, even the linear accelerator using X-ray, which is artificial source of radiation, which is called ionizing radiation. But in nuclear medicine department, we are using radioactive material, which emitting gamma ray or gamma radiation, which is a natural source of radiation. So what's the difference between the ionizing and non-ionizing radiation? The ionizing radiation here, the radiation has enough energy to knock out electron from the atom. So the atom itself could convert it to ion. That's why I'm calling it ionizing radiation. But if we are talking about non-ionizing radiation, we are talking about the radiation which has no enough energy to knock out electron from the atom. So it's called non-ionizing radiation. Can you give me an example for non-ionizing radiation? Every day we are using MRI machine, magnetic resonance imaging, which is non-ionizing source or non-ionizing radiation source used every day for scanning patient. Also radio waves, TV, mobile tower is the sources of non-ionizing radiation. So ionizing radiation has enough power to knock out electron from the atom, high energy, high frequency, low wavelength, cause ionization. While non-ionizing radiation, low energy, low frequency, high wavelength, it cannot cause any ionization. But what about the ultrasound? Do you think that the ultrasound is a type of ionizing or non-ionizing? Ultrasound is a mechanical waves. It's not ionizing or non-ionizing. It's another type of radiation, which is called mechanical waves. So the main difference between ionizing and ionizing radiation, ionizing radiation produce ions, can cause ionization process. Why? Because it has a higher energy, which can knock out electron from the atom. While non-ionizing radiation has no enough energy to knock out electron from the atom, so ions will not be reduced inside your body. Here, as you can see, if we have an atom, and you'll find inside the atom here the nucleus, which contain protons and neutrons, and around the nucleus, you'll find the electrons moving around in electronic shells. So if the energy enough to knock out electron from the atom, so at that time, it becomes ion. Okay. As you can see here, the gamma photon or X-ray or ionizing type of radiation knock out the electron from that. I'm sorry, 1 second. Here, if you are exposed to ionizing and non-ionizing radiation, you will find that ionizing radiation causing ions produced inside your body. These ions attack your body, attack your DNA, which might cause damage, and this damage might cause cancer, or might cause cell death or apoptosis. It depends on the dose of radiation itself and type of radiation as well. Okay, so when radiation interacts with your body, so the radiation causes ionization. If you are talking about the ionizing radiation, which might cause damage to your DNA, this damage, okay, it might be repaired and might not be repaired. If the cell able to repair the damage at that time, there is no problem. The cell become healthy again. But if this repair failed, at that time, cell death process will start, or cell apoptosis will start. Or if it's partially repaired, it might cause cancer or genetic disease. So I want you to put in your mind, if the damage happened inside your DNA, so we have three probability. One of them completely repaired, so at that time the cell become healthy again. No worries about that. But if the repair failed, at that time cell apoptosis or cell death process start. And if it's partially repaired, at that time, or not partially, if it's repaired wrongly, okay, at that time it might cause mutation or cancer disease. Here we will talk about the types of radiation according to the source of radiation. We have many man-made source of radiation and natural source of radiation. If you are talking about man-made source of radiation, we are talking about X-ray machines, because we have an X-ray tube. This X-ray tube used to produce X-ray, used every day for fluoroscopy, dental X-ray, linear accelerator mammography, CBCT, bone mineral density, computed tomography. So we have many artificial sources for ionizing radiation, okay, used nowadays. And also we have natural source of radiation which emitting, or natural radioactive material which used for emitting gamma rays or alpha particles or beta particles. So now, if you are talking about the man-made source of radiation, you are talking about X-ray tube. This X-ray tube composed of cathode and anode. This cathode is the source of electron, and anode, it's like this is the positive part inside the X-ray tube. Okay, the cathode itself produce electrons, which accelerated by the potential difference between the anode and the cathode to produce the X-ray. This X-ray produced by Bremer-Strahlung X-ray interaction or characteristic X-ray. This is not our scope in this lecture, okay? So we will talk about the natural source of radiation. Let me ask you one question. Why radioactive material is radioactive? If you ask yourself, why radioactive material is radioactive? Why the atom itself is unstable? What's the reason behind that? You will find that the nucleus itself contains protons and neutrons. So you will find that if there is imbalance between the number of protons and number of neutrons, the atom itself or the nucleus itself become radioactive or become unstable. You can understand that if there is excess number of protons, okay, so this number of protons will make repulsion, because so many protons inside the nucleus, it will cause repulsion. So at that time, the nucleus itself tends to be more stable. So the nucleus itself will convert one proton to neutron to be more stable. But if there are excess number of neutrons inside the atom, so that means that number of neutrons is very high. So what's the reason behind the nuclear instability in this case? You can understand, if there are many protons, so positive charged proton, so repulsion, so the atom or the nucleus become unstable. You can understand this. But if you are talking about if there are excess number of protons, why the nucleus itself become unstable? There are assumption here or theory which talking about that there are quarks or particles inside the proton and the neutrons. You'll find here inside the proton two up quark and one down quark. you will find here that the charge of up quark is positive 2/3, while the charge of down quark is negative 1/3. So the summation of all these charge will be plus 1. That's the reason why you will find the proton has a charge of plus 1. And neutron itself, you will find inside the neutrons 2 down quark and 1 up quark. The up quark, as I mentioned before, has a charge plus 2/3, while the down quark has a charge of minus 1/3 or negative 1/3. So the summation of all these charge will result 0. That's why you will find the neutron has a charge of 0. So you will find here inside there are balance between neutrons and protons numbers. Why? Because the quarks itself inside the neutrons, okay, attract each other or repel each other. So that's why if there are excess number of neutrons, okay, that cause the repulsion force between the quarks itself inside the neutrons. That's why that if there are excess number of neutrons, the nucleus itself become unstable. So the nucleus tends to be stable. So the neutrons, so here, as you can see here, there is our interaction between the quarks inside the neutron and the protons, which cause more repulsion or more attraction. It depends on the number or the balance between number of neutrons and protons. So here, if the atom itself or the nucleus itself is radioactive or unstable, because there are excess number of protons or excess number of neutrons, the nucleus tends to be more stable by emitting alpha particle or beta particles or neutrons or gamma radiation. Okay, this is the reason why the nucleus itself is unstable or radioactive. Okay, so if you are talking about the alpha particle, which happen for Z number over 83 for heavy atoms, okay, which is radioactive or unstable, at that time it will emit alpha particle. This alpha particle has lowest penetration power. Why? Because it's a particle and it's a heavy particle. It's a helium atom. So at that time, this charged particle, which has a charge plus 2, will make ionization in a very short distance. So alpha particle deposit all its energy in a very short distance. So if you are talking about alpha particle source, okay, so you know very well that alpha particle will deposit its energy in a very short distance. Why? Because it's a heavy particle and has a charge which causes ionization with all surrounded atoms. So it has a higher ionization power, or it's called high linear energy transfer, high lect, L-E-T, linear energy transfer. How much energy deposited per unit of length. So here, as you can see here, alpha particle will interact with atoms around and deposit all its energy in very short distance. That's why you can stop alpha particle, okay, by a thin sheet of paper. No need to make more shielding for any alpha particle source. If you have any radioactive material which contain or which emit alpha particle, you can use only thin sheet of paper to stop it, because it deposits all its energy in a very short distance. That's why we have to use radioactive source which emit alpha particles only for treatment, not for imaging. Why? Because alpha particle deposit all its energy inside the patient. If you inject the patient with radioactive material which emit alpha particle, at that time the alpha particle will deposit all its energy inside the patient. It's localized inside the tumor. But why I'm not using alpha particle sources for imaging? Because alpha particle has no power enough to go out the patient to be detected by gamma camera or SPECT machine. So you want to detect the radiation coming out from the patient, but alpha particle will be totally absorbed inside the patient. We'll talk about another type of decay, which is called beta plus decay. Here, if there are excess number of protons, so at that time, the nucleus itself will convert one proton to neutron, okay, which emit here positron. This positron is like electron, but has a positive charge. This positron will collide with any electron around to annihilate to two gamma photon 180 degree to each other. This phenomena used for, or this principle used for positron emission tomography. Nowadays, we are using F18 or FDG, fluorodeoxyglucose, which is a positron emitter, okay, to emit two gamma photon 180 degree to each other to be detected by PET scanner. So, this is another type of decay which happens if there is excess number of protons. But here, if there is excess number of neutrons, the atom itself or the nucleus become unstable. So, to be more stable, the nucleus will convert one neutron to proton. So it will emit beta particle or beta minus, which has negative charge. Beta minus, okay, has a middle ionization power and middle penetration power. It's not equal to alpha particle, but it's higher than alpha particle in ionization and penetration. And it is the middle. It's not like beta alpha particle. And it's not like gamma radiation. If we are talking about the gamma radiation here or gamma decay, okay, which happen and fall with after alpha particle and beta particle decay, you will find gamma radiation going out from the nucleus, okay, following alpha decay or beta minus or beta plus decay as well. Gamma radiation has a higher penetration power, has lowest ionization power because it has no charge. So it will not interact with atoms around. Okay, it's very less interaction between atoms around, not like beta particle, which has a charge and it's a particle. But we are talking about gamma radiation, which is a photon, has no charge. So highest penetration power, so it can penetrate or it can go out the patient, so it can be detected by gamma camera or SPECT machine. So now, if you are thinking about radioactive material or radiopharmaceutical used for imaging, you will think about radioactive source which emit gamma radiation. If you are thinking about radioactive material used for treatment, you will think about radioactive material which emit beta particle or alpha particle. Beta particle as well deposit all its energy in short distance. The highest ionization or the high ionization density here in alpha particle, which contain two protons and two neutrons, it's helium nuclei, it's charged particle plus two, while beta particle it's like electrons or positron, charged particle negative or positive. Low ionization density, lower than alpha particle, while gamma ray or X-ray has the same properties and low ionization density and the high penetration power. That's why you will find iodine-131, which is commonly used in nuclear medicine, which emitting beta particle nowadays. Iodine-131 is very important for thyroid cancer treatment. It emit, iodine-131 emit beta particle, which deposits all its energy inside the thyroid for thyroid cancer treatment. But also, iodine-131 emit gamma radiation 365. That's why if you are dealing with iodine-131, you have to be careful about that, because the patient himself emit gamma radiation and iodine had half-life, which is around eight days. And inside the patient, you will find that the effective half-life is around 5 days. So, you have to know the radioactive material, which particle or which type of radiation emitted from the radioactive material. That's important. That's important to protect yourself. That's important for shielding purpose. That's important for the usage of radioactive material itself. So for alpha particle here, you can stop it by thin paper. you can stop it. But beta particle, you need a low density material like perspex or aluminum. You have to, you can stop it by using low density material. That's why if you are dealing with radioactive material which emit beta particle, you cannot use high density material. Why? Because beta particle interact with high density material and they produce Bremsstrahlung X-ray. So be careful about that. We have to use perspex material or a searing shell, the specific searing shell used from perspex, okay, to absorb all beta particles emitted by radioactive material and prevent production of Bremsstrahlung X-ray. But if you are dealing with gamma radiation or X-ray, you have to use, for searing shell, you have to use high density material like lead. So it's important to know the type of radiation and the radioactive material you are dealing with. Here, gamma radiation can penetrate thin paper, can penetrate aluminum or low density material, but it will be stopped by lead material, high thickness or which has a required thickness. That's why for you as a radiation safety officer or a medical physicist, in nuclear medicine department, you will find that the hot lab contain many or different radioactive sources. And also if you are preparing iodine therapy rooms, so you have patient which is injected with iodine-131, which emitting gamma radiation. So you have to shield the rooms in the hot lab or isolated room for patient for iodine therapy or waste room or any room contain radioactive material which emit gamma radiation by proper thickness of lead, which able to prevent any radiation leakage to the public or to the other staff or non-radiation worker. So that's important to know if you are doing shielding calculation, to know the usage of this room, for which purpose we are using this room for containing, for storing radioactive sources, which type of radioactive sources, what are the activity of radioactive sources, what is the energy of radioactive sources, which type of radiation emitted from the radioactive sources. That's important to be considered in your calculation. And also, if you are dealing with any patient, and this patient injected with pure beta source or pure gamma source of radiation, that means there is no radiation will go out from the patient. But if you are dealing with a patient which injected with radioactive material emitting gamma radiation, so you have to follow ICRP principle, time distance shielding, when you are dealing with them. As you can see here, this is our survey meter. We can use it for radiation detector, okay, for radiation detection. As you can see, if we have here alpha radiation source, okay, you will find here the reading going up. That means this cup, this is called Landrum survey meter, is used for radiation as a radiation detector. Okay, here you will find that the reading goes up, okay, when you are moving the source close to the this detector or this hand. Okay, how can I stop it? Using only thin sheet of paper, as you can see. So the reading here would be lower because you stop the alpha particle going out from the radioactive source. Here we will replace this source with another source which emitting beta particle. Okay, and we will try again to stop the beta particle coming out from the radioactive source. At longer distance, the radiation detector will detect the radiation, will detect the beta particle. Why? Because the beta particles in air has a longer range than alpha particles. So here you can detect a certain value of radiation. If you are using paper to prevent the beta particle to reach the detector, it will not be effective. But you have to use perspex material or low density material, okay, to prevent the beta particle reaching the detector. you'll find here the reading become lower on using the perspex material or low density material like aluminum. That's why you will find many searing shield used for lutetium as a beta source, okay, for pure beta emitters you can use, or even for yttrium 90 as a beta source, okay. We can use low density material or perspex used. It's manufactured by perspex material. Here it's a gamma source of radiation. You can detect the reading here. If you are using a thin sheet of paper, you will not. It will not prevent any. It will not prevent anything. And even you are, if you are using the perspex material. So what is the effective shielding material here? It will be lead material. So you have to put the proper thickness, okay, of lead material to prevent the radiation or the gamma photon to reach the detector. So now you know the difference between gamma and alpha and beta. Okay? So here, distance travel in air from alpha particle is 1 to 10 centimeter. If you are talking about inside the patient, it takes several tenths of micrometers. If you are talking about alpha particles. If you move to beta particles here, you will find the distance traveled by beta particle several meters. It depends on the energy of beta particle as well, because as you know, beta particles are produced in a spectrum or in a range of energies. It has not only one value of energy, but it's like a spectrum of energies. Okay, and the mean energy is 1/3 the maximum energy of beta particle. So when the beta particle interacts with your body, okay, it penetrates only several millimeters inside your body. But alpha particles only penetrate several micrometers inside your body. Here, if you are talking about gamma radiation in the X-ray, has a higher penetration power, okay, and low ionization density, so it's several tens of meter outside the patient. And if it's going inside the patient, okay, it will travel several centimeters, depends on the amounts of energy as well. Because if you are talking about gamma radiation or X-ray radiation, which has low energy, it will goes to a third interaction. It might be photoelectric effect, which is dominant below 40 kilo electron volt or at lower energy of gamma radiation. But if you are talking about higher level of energy, so the predominant interaction will be the Compton scattering. At that time, many scatter photon will goes out of the patient. So it depends on the energy, because the energy will determine the type of interaction happen inside the patient or inside your body. So for low energy, you are talking about photoelectric effect as a dominant interaction, which might cause totally absorption of the photons. So here, if the radioactive material located outside the body here, alpha particle, okay, it will not penetrate only the skin, as you can see. Beta particles will go inside several millimeters. Here, micrometer for gamma radiation, it will go inside. If the patient himself injected with radioactive material, which emit alpha particle, it will not go outside the patient. While beta particle is the same, but it will longer distance than alpha particle. For gamma radiation, it will move longer distance and penetrate the patient body to reach the gamma camera or to reach the scanner machine. In nuclear medicine department, you have SPECT CT and PET CT. Nowadays, we are using CT for attenuation correction and for localization as well. If you are injecting patient with radioactive material or radiopharmaceutical, it depends, the type of radiopharmaceutical, it depends on the techniques you are using. For example, if you are using PET CT machine, so you will inject the patient with FDG, or gallium BSMA, which has a higher energy, which reaches to 511 kilo electron volt. So you have to know the type of radiation. That's very important. So we are talking about F-18 or gallium source of radiation. So which emit positron, which collide with electron around to emit or to produce two gamma photon 180 degree to each other. Each photon has 511 kilo electron volt. So you have to consider that in your shielding calculation as well, the type of radioactive material and also the time half-life. If you are talking about F18, so you are talking about 110 minutes time half-life. If you are talking about gallium-68, you are talking about 68 minutes. That's important in your calculation and in your waste management as well. If any waste coming out from the patient, like syringe, like used for PET imaging, at that time, it will take short time for decay to reach the background level. So you can discard it easily. Even and also the excreta coming out from the patient, which is injected with F18 or FDG or gallium PSMA, it has short half-life. So it will decay very fast. But if we are talking about SPECT CT machine, which used for another isotopes like technetium, which is the most common radioactive source used nowadays for gamma camera or gamma imaging, which has a half-life 6 hours and energy 140 kilo electron volt. So you are talking about lower energy but longer half-life. If you are talking about iodine-131, which has 8 days time half-life and also iodine-131 is a beta source. So you are talking about beta emitters and at the same time gamma emitters. So you have to know if you are going to do the calculation or to deal with any patient in nuclear medicine department, you have to know which type of radioactive sources we are using in our department. We have a SPECT CT machine, so we are dealing with different radioactive sources like gallium-67, like iodine-131, technetium. So you have to know the energy time half-life for each radioactive source we are using in your department. Why? Because any waste coming out from iodine or technetium, you have to store it for a certain time, which depends on the half-life. By regulation, it's 10 times the half-life of the radioactive source. And you have to measure that to assure that the reading is background. After that, you have to discard it as a normal waste. But if you are talking about PET CT radioactive sources like gallium or like FDG, it's a very fast radioactive source which decay very fast. At that time, the waste may be 24 hours, that's enough. Maybe less than this, because we are injecting nowadays very low activity of FDG and gallium. But for technetium, it depends on the scan itself. If you are talking about cardiac scan, you are injecting, it might reach per day 40 millicurie if the patient coming to do stress and rest study. So you are injecting the patient high radioactive or high amount of radioactive material. Or thyroid scan 5 millicurie or renal scan 3 to 5 millicurie. It depends on the procedure itself. But if you are dealing with iodine therapy at that time, you are dealing with high radioactive sources or high amount of radioactivity. It might reach to 200 millicurie for iodine. So all these parameters should be considered in your calculation and in your waste management as well. As I informed you, we are using a radioactive material labeled with a certain radiopharmaceutical which form a label compound. This label compound will be targeted. For example, if you are using radioactive material for cardiac imaging, so you have to label the radioactive material with a certain chemical compound, which is called MEBI, okay? And you have to inject the patient. So the radioactive material will be moved through the bloodstream to reach the cardiac or the myocardial wall. Who is carrying or who is moving, why the radioactive material moved through the bloodstream to go to reach the myocardial wall, the chemical compound itself. Which chemical compound? MEBI. It's called MEBI, mesoxyisobutyl isonitrile. It's used for cardiac imaging. So you have different chemical compound used nowadays to be labeled with maybe the same radioactive material like technetium to be targeted to a certain organ for imaging or for therapy as well. Here, as you can see here, the searing shield used for shielding or used for preventing the radiation coming out from the searing, which contain radioactive material during injection process. This is our SPECT machine used nowadays. You have two heads machine, okay? Two heads, this head contain crystal, different components used for imaging. As you can see here, we can rotate these heads, okay, around the patient to detect or to get different projection or different angles around the patient. And also we can both the heads in 90 degree position or 180 degree position. At that time, the patient injected with radioactive material and going through the scanning process and go inside and be under these heads, okay, to get finally the image for diagnosis. As you can see here, this is a radioactive material. So in nuclear medicine department, you will find the patient himself become a source of radioactive material. So the patient coming out from outside from the reception area, after taking off his clothes, the patient prepared, cannulated, and staying at holding area. At the same time, the technologist preparing the radioactive material. So the radioactive material coming from the hot lab, okay, and injected to the patient, so the patient himself will emit the radiation. This radiation here, if it's used for imaging, so it has to be gamma radiation. So be careful about that if you are talking with patient and giving him instructions after radioactive injection. So you have to give the patient all instruction before injection of radiopharmaceutical. You'll find many applications for gamma camera like renal scan. As you can see here, we can detect the glomerular filtration rate or the kidney function using technetium DTPA or technetium MAG3. Okay, by injecting the patient 3 to 5 millicurie, and you can see here the kidney, or here the kidney, here right kidney and left kidney, already the radioactive material accumulated inside the kidney. And by time you can take dynamic scan and you can see here the bladder, which is filled with radioactive material. That means that the patient has a good glomerular filtration rate, or used for bone scan to detect any cancer. Also, we can use the radioactive material technetium to be labeled with MDB, mesoxydiphosphonate, which is targeted to the inflammation or the bone itself, because it contains a phosphate compound, which is used for bone building, used for building the bone material or the bone matrix itself. That's why you will find if there is any inflammation or metastasis, okay, which require many phosphate groups, which is inside MDB, which labeled with technetium source. So at that time, you will find here many hot spots which contain radioactive material, which express about that there is something wrong. There is a hot lesions or metastasis or cancer or inflammation. Okay, it based on the clinical history of the patient himself. Also, we are using a CT to obtain SPECT CT image, okay, for proper localization and for attenuation correction as well. So you have to put in your mind that the patient come to your department will be injected with radioactive material. So that's mean you will, the patient will absorb radiation, or the patient dose will come from the radioactive material and CT as well, because you are using nowadays CT for attenuation correction and radiopharmaceutical localization. So you have to calculate the patient dose come from where, from the radioactive material and the CT machine as well. Also in PET CT, you have two gantries here. One gantry used for PET and another gantry used for CT. So here we are using CT, which is mandatory in PET CT for attenuation correction and the proper localization of radioactive material. So here we are injecting the patient in PET CT with F18 or fluorodeoxyglucose. This FDG produces 511 kilo electron volt to gamma photons, which are 180 degree to each other. After injection of the patient, injecting the patient with the radio tracer or FDG, we will leave the patient for 1 hour, okay, for a good biodistribution of FDG, and the tumor take the FDG because it's a glucose source, used it for building or cell growth, okay, higher than the normal cells. That's why we have to we are using FDG for tumor detection. Why? Because the tumor itself using the glucose for cell growth. As you can see here, two gamma photon annihilated here, as you can see, 180 degree each other, which is detected. So in PET-CT, also you have patient. This patient injected with radioactive material. So the patient himself become a source of radiation, and patient himself get radiation from the radioactive material and from the CT part as well. And also, as you can see here, we are using, this is a CT and this is a PET image. After fusion, you will get this image. Okay, this image here expresses the localization of the tumor. As you can see, you know the location. Here you cannot determine exactly where is the radioactive material or where is the tumor. But here by fusion, you can know exactly the location of the tumor. Okay, and also you cannot get a proper image of PET image. You cannot get a proper PET image without attenuation correction. Now, we will move to the biological effects of radiation. Are you tired? Or it's okay? Are you hearing me? Okay, shall I continue? Okay. I want you to open your mind if we are talking about the biological effects of radiation. Here, if we are talking about biological effects of radiation, as I informed you before, that we are dealing with ionizing radiation. Alpha particle or beta particle or gamma rays are source of ionizing radiation, which interact with your body and they produce many ions or free radicals. But you have to ask yourself at the beginning, do we need radiation protection? You'll find a lot of incidents happen from radiation exposure. As you can see here, there are hair loss. Okay, having for this patient this patient already did CT perfusion, and because of the high acquisition parameters, this patient suffer from hair loss. Why? Because this effect is an effect under the deterministic effect of radiation. So you'll find instant like that or accident like that happen for patients. Like what? Like skin damage happen for fluoroscopic patients or patient undergoing fluoroscopic procedure. You will find that the patient dose in under fluoroscopy or intervention radiologist, the patient received too much dose, and you will find skin burn or tissue damage, which appear maybe months after the procedure itself, because of the improper use of the machine itself. As you can see here, ICRB85 already launched a report talking about avoidance of radiation injury from interventional procedures. Because ICRB recorded many patients suffer from radiation damage or skin damage. That means there is radiation effect. And also, all workers here, interventional workers, suffer from cataract. That's why you will find the dose limit for eye reduced from 150 millisievert to 20 millisievert, because many interventional radiologists suffer from cataract because of the radiation exposure. So that means there is radiation effects around us. But if we are talking about cataract or talking about skin burn or erythema, we are talking about the deterministic effect of radiation. So I want you to put in your mind something. There are two main effects of radiation. One of them is called deterministic effect, and the other effect is called stochastic effect. The deterministic effect of radiation, it's dose dependent. And the severity of the effect increases by dose. When the dose increase, the severity increase. And this effect happen after certain threshold. So below this threshold, there is no deterministic effect. Threshold is 100 milligray. So deterministic effect like scamber, like sterility, like cataract, it happened after threshold, and it's a dose dependent, and the severity of the effect increased by dose. So how the deterministic effect happened? The radiation itself interact with the DNA and cause ionization or cause damage. Every day, inside your body, inside your cell, 10,000 to 1 million location damage happen to your DNA. Every day, 10,000 to 1 million location damage inside your DNA. But the cell itself, this is without radiation, without anything, it's normally happen. But the cell itself produce repair enzyme which fixes the damage. So, under radiation exposure, the damage increase. That means if the enzyme or repair enzyme enable to fix this error or to fix the damage, so I have three probability. If the damage fix it, so no problem. So it become healthy again. So if the damage itself unrepaired, so cell apoptosis or cell death will be initiated. And this causes the deterministic effect of radiation. As you can see here, the radiation interact in a very short time, as 1,000 of second after irradiation, DNA breaks happen and base damage occur. In a second after irradiation, DNA repair start. And if the repair fail, cell death and mutation occur within an hour to one day. It takes some time until such reaction at the cell level develop into clinical symptoms at an individual level. This period is called incubation period. So here, this is a physical process which happened in 1,000 seconds. So after 1 second, okay, after irradiation, DNA repair start. So repairing happened after 1 second of irradiation. So within 1 second, or 1,000 seconds, the production or the interaction happened. The production of free radicals, which attacks the DNA, all this happen in less than 1 second. So after 1 second, DNA repair start. Okay, so if the repair itself fail, it might cause cell death or cell degeneration. So at that time, it's called, it will cause acute radiation syndromes like fetal effects or cataract, which will be under the deterministic effect. So the deterministic effect here, the radiation interact with the DNA, DNA damage happen in the base, in amine base, or single strand breaks or double strand breaks. The highest probability for base damage. Then single strand breaks, then double strand breaks. It depends on the energy of radiation or the linear energy transfer of the radiation which interact with the DNA. If the radiation let or the amount of energy deposited per unit of length increase, high let, that means the probability of double strand breaks increase. Only one double strand breaks might happen, might cause, or will cause kill of the cell. Will cause killing of the cell. So here, DNA damage happen, okay? So incomplete repair, it might cause mutation, which cause cancer. cancer or hereditary disease. So now we are talking about the stochastic effect. So in case the repair is incomplete, at that time mutation will happen. So cancer and hereditary effects will appear. It might appear after 20 years. But if the repair failed, cell death or cell degeneration will be happen. So it will cause acute effects and fetal effects, which is under the deterministic effect. But if the repair succeed, at that time there is no hazard. So stochastic effect means that the repair is incomplete or partially, and mutation happen. So now, if we are talking about the deterministic effect, we are talking about a 13 threshold. Beyond this threshold, the radiation effect will appear. But if we are talking about the stochastic effect, there is no threshold. Here, this is a curve representing deterministic effect. Here, at 13 threshold, okay, the effect increased by dose. But here in the stochastic effect, there is still probability because one photon might cause cancer. So cancer or leukemia or hereditary effects, it happened even by one photon or one single exposure. That's why we have to protect ourselves from the radiation effects. Why? Because the threshold for deterministic effect is 100 milligray. And this value is very high. You will not find any radiation worker in nuclear medicine department get this value. Because we are dealing with low level of radiation exposure. I'm talking about in a normal situation, not in radiation incident. In normal situation, all radiation workers, okay, will get a low level of radiation exposure. You will not exceed 100 milligray. That's why for radiation workers, the dose limit is 20 millisieverts per year. So why shall I protect myself from radiation hazard? Because one photon might cause cancer. And the probability of cancer increase by increasing the dose, not the severity. Here I'm talking about the probability. So if you are talking about the stochastic effect, you are talking about the probability increase by dose. If you are talking about deterministic effect, so the severity increase by dose. You have to put that in your mind. That's why you have to follow radiation protection principle. Why? To reduce the probability of cancer and hereditary or leukemia or stochastic effect as a whole. For patient, you might find patient in computed tomography get 100 milligray. You might find patient under interventional procedure get higher than 100 milligray. As I show you before, the skin damage, it comes from a dose which is around 2 gray. So it exceeds the threshold of deterministic effect. So for radiation worker, if anyone informed you, we are dealing with low level of radiation exposure, you have to tell him one photon might cause cancer. And you have to reduce the probability of cancer and hereditary disease. Here we will talk quickly about the radiation measurements. How can I measure the radiation? Like weight, you have to measure the radiation by, you have to measure the weight by mass or by kilograms. This is the unit of radiation. This is the unit of weight. But if you are talking about the radiation, also you have to get a certain units for the radiation. There are four main definitions. You have to put it in your mind. Exposure dose, absorbed dose, equivalent dose, effective dose. And before exposure or absorbed or equivalent or effective dose, you have to know what the meaning of activity. Activity means If you are mentioning that I have a source of radiation which has an activity 1 millicurie or 2 millicurie, what does it mean? If you are talking about the radioactivity of any material, you are talking about the number of decays per second. How many atoms will be converted from unstable state to stable state per second? One decay per second or one conversion from instability to stability state, you are talking about the Becquerel. So Becquerel is the one decay per second. This is a unit of radioactivity. So how much becquerels the radioactive material has? So it represents the disintegration rate per second, or how many radioactive material become stable per second. So you have to put that in your mind. If you are talking about highest activity, that means highest conversion of radioactive material per second from unstable state to stable state. That means high emission of gamma radiation or alpha or beta. So increasing the activity, increasing the products or the emitters from the radioactive material. Exposure dose, now if I throw a cup of water on you, now you are exposed to a whole amount of water inside the cup. But your body will not absorb all this amount of water. Same like radiation, if you are exposed to radiation coming out from a certain radioactive source, you are exposed to whole amount of radiation. This is the exposure dose. It doesn't mean that your body will absorb all this amount. That's why we have another definition which is called absorbed dose. So the exposure dose represents the amount of ions produced inside the air due to radiation exposure, which has a unit coulomb per kilogram. And we have another unit which is called Rontgen. But if we are talking about absorbed dose, we are talking about the radiation absorbed by your body. So we are talking about amount of energy absorbed by your body. So we are talking about joule per kilogram, so we are talking about gray unit. But we have different types of radiation. We have alpha particle, beta particle, gamma radiation. Not all radiation types have the same ionization power. Not all radiation type cause the same effect, because alpha particle is dense particle, cause highest ionization in a very short distance. While beta particle has a longer range and gamma radiation has less ionization power. So if you get alpha source inside your body, so this alpha source will produce alpha particle, which deposit all its energy inside your body. They found that the effect coming out from alpha particle is 20 times greater than the effect of beta particles or gamma or X-ray. That's why we have radiation weighting factor, which consider the type of radiation. So we have another definition, which is called equivalent dose, which is equal to the absorbed dose multiplied by the radiation weighting factor. So the absorbed dose doesn't consider the radiation type, but the equivalent dose considers the radiation type. So we have to multiply the absorbed dose by the radiation weighting factor, which is 20 for alpha particle, but 1 for beta particles or gamma or X-ray. So the unit of equivalent dose is sievert. Okay, which part of your body absorbs the radiation? We have different parts. We have neck, chest, head, abdomen, pelvis. Each part has a certain sensitivity to radiation. Not all parts inside your body have the same sensitivity to radiation. So we have to consider the sensitivity factor or the sensitivity of different organs inside your body. That's why we have another definition, which is called effective dose, which consider the tissue weighting factor or the sensitivity of the organs inside your body. So the effective dose is equal to the equivalent dose multiplied by the tissue weighting factor. So there are four main important definitions you have to know very well how to convert from absorbed dose, equivalent dose, effective dose. And that's very important to know very well for patient. For example, if patient going to do CT, so at that time you will find different dose quantities like DLB, dose length product. So you have to know how to convert from DLB to the effective dose. Okay, so here, as I informed you, for X-ray, gamma ray, or beta, tissue weighting factor here, I'm sorry, this is radiation weighting factor, is 1. For proton beam is 2. For alpha particle or heavy ion, 20. For neutron beams, we have a range from 2.5 to 21. Here, for tissue weighting factor, it depends on sensitivity. You will find that breast, stomach, lung, colon, red bone marrow, which is highly productive organs, which has a high production rate or high productive cells, so has these organs have highly tissue weighting factor. Okay, while gonad or bladder or bone surface, okay, everyone has a certain value of tissue weighting factor. It depends on the production rate inside the organ itself. Okay, so because there is no time, thank you so much. Okay, I try to go quickly. Okay, hopefully you get more information and you got good information. So I prepared the presentation I prepared the presentation including too many informations, okay? But there is no time, or we can delay for next time. We can talk more and more about the biological effect or many information. So if you have any questions, I'll be more welcome to hear from you. Thank you so much. Thank you. You are most welcome. Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay, really, really appreciate your comment. Really appreciate your comment, Wallah. Thank you so much. You will find the lecture, inshallah, on the YouTube channel, okay? You will find all lecture there. For whom register today, okay? I will share the material with you. And if you have any questions, and only the attendees for today will continue with me in the training course and will attend the exam finally, okay? I'm trying to prepare more courses with you, inshallah, to get accreditation from DOH, Department of Health here in UAE, okay, to be more professional for everyone, okay? Actually, I'm trying to transfer my knowledge, okay? I don't care about the accreditation or the certificate accreditation, but I'll try my best to get proper accreditation for everyone. Okay, thank you so much. Do you have any questions before I leave you? Thanks so much. Okay, thank you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Thank you.